It is now my privilege and honor to introduce a very special guest, Dr. Dave Chokshi, the new Commissioner of Health for the City of New York, the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. He is, as many of you know, formerly with Health and Hospitals, where he built and grew an award-winning team dedicated to the health system improvement, spanning innovative care models and analytics, primary care transformation, social determinants of health, our mantra here at the school, community-based care management, and chronic disease and prevention. He has also cared for patients as a primary care provider at our favorite hospital, Bellevue, since 2014. Commissioner Chokshi, on behalf of our entire faculty and staff, welcome to this important position at this critical time in New York's history. We know that under your leadership, it will continue to weather the COVID-19 pandemic with grace and success. We look forward to hearing more about your plans for safeguarding New Yorkers in the few minutes we have here with you. We know you're a very, very busy person. Please join me, all of you, in welcoming Commissioner Dave Chokshi.
Thank you so much for that warm introduction, Dean Hilton, and for having me here just for a few minutes. You know, I know these must be particularly cherished moments that you all get, even if virtual, because I know from my own experience how important the vibrant community is to the life of the mind and to all of the important work that you're all doing together. So thanks for allowing me to have this brief interlude with all of you. I just wanted to share, you know, a few thoughts with respect to, you know, to this extraordinary moment that we're in, how I'm thinking about it, how I've tried to orient our department to contribute to what needs to happen in this historic time, and then a little bit about how, you know, I hope we can all work in partnership, since this is also an all hands on deck moment. But let me briefly just start by saying what I know all of you already know, and what all of you feel in so many ways, which is that it is not hyperbole to say that this is a truly historic moment for all of us. It's historic with respect to the depth of tragedy that all of us have borne witness to. It's historic with respect to the multiple overlapping challenges that we're confronting, from the COVID-19 pandemic to seeing it intersect with the legacy of structural racism in our country and in our city, to taking, you know, what many of us have been fighting for many years around social justice and the social determinants of health, and having to confront that we are in a period of great social and economic upheaval related to the pandemic as well. And all of these things are interconnected, you know, in an unfortunate Gordian knot that has affected, you know, too many people. But rather than, you know, feeling paralyzed or feeling like those are things that are unable to be surmounted, at least for me, and I know for so many of you as well, this is extraordinary motivation at the same time. It feels like one of those moments, and I say this, you know, at the health department in particular, one of those moments that we've all been preparing our entire lives for, you know, to step up to the challenges on behalf of the people that we intend to serve. And here at DOHMH, there are so many people who have been working for years, for decades, to put the systems in place, to develop the expertise and experience to be able to rise to the challenges that we have right now. So that's my, you know, that's what gets me out of bed every morning, is one way of putting it. And, you know, we've tried to take both the historic legacy of the health department and make sure that it is matched to the moment that I've just described. And so just in my, you know, first couple of months on the job, I have sought to make sure that in the, you know, the maelstrom that we're in right now, where it can feel difficult to know what it is that we can have a firm grasp on, and you know, and and root the important work that we have to do. So I've found that, you know, the most useful place to start in the conversations about our work is with our core values, which some of you have heard me speak about already. But for the health department, we seek to make sure that science, equity, and compassion are the core values that everything else flows from. Our mission, our vision of what needs to happen, both during the pandemic as well as beyond. And then as we get a little bit more into the brass tacks, our strategic priorities as well. But I find as we confront so many difficult decisions where unfortunately the right path is not always clear, having those values firmly in mind, talking about them as much as possible, and then bringing them to bear for the most difficult decisions is one way of sorting through the challenges that we're facing. Taking that to a more concrete level, the other way that we have thought about organizing our work in this momentous time is to be clear about the fact that public health is much broader than responding to a pandemic, of course. It has to do with ensuring healthy childhoods, with making sure that we have a place-based focus with respect to health. It has to do with implementing anti-racist public health practice. It has to do with bridging public health and healthcare, which is something that I'm particularly passionate about. But I'm also convinced that we will not successfully get to all of those important priorities if we don't have a robust and successful COVID-19 response. And so we have we've been very hard-nosed about making sure that our resources and attention are focused on COVID-19 for New York City, so that we can also take on all of those other important challenges. And so I have three priorities, you know, within our COVID-19 response. The first is to rapidly mitigate resurgence, and we're in the midst of this right now. We're seeing upticks in many neighborhoods, particularly in Brooklyn and Queens, and potentially in other areas as well. And our job is to bring data to bear, but also swift action to mitigate resurgence as it happens. The second is to plan and prepare for historic vaccination campaigns. You know, certainly the COVID-19 vaccine when it becomes available, but as you see from my button, also our influenza vaccination campaign this fall. And I have a simple goal for our flu vaccination campaign this year, which is I want to get more New Yorkers vaccinated against influenza than has ever been done before in the history of the city. And I think we can do it, given the attention that's being focused and given the public messaging that we're able to bring to bear around it. Importantly, whether it's the flu vaccine or the COVID-19 vaccine, this has to be done in partnership with the communities that we're serving. It has to acknowledge that there are reasons that vaccination and vaccine uptake is not as easy as one would hope based on the evidence around vaccination. And that has to do with the complexity of historical distrust engendered in communities, particularly with Black and Brown New Yorkers. That's related to historical injustice, including historical injustices and intersecting with the healthcare systems that that are supposed to have served those communities. So the second priority is around vaccination, laying the groundwork this fall with the flu and preparing for COVID-19. And then the third, and I know so many of you have been thoughtful about this, this part of it in particular, is what we put under the rubric of parallel pandemics. All of those things that travel in concert or in the wake of COVID-19, and certainly from my clinical practice, I've borne witness to so much of this in a tragic way. People who suffer from ill effects related to mental health, perhaps because of bereavement related to COVID-19, but perhaps because of that social and economic upheaval. I have too many faces of my patients in mind whose lives have been disrupted and really just turned upside down because they're struggling to figure out how to make rent, how to make sure that there's enough food for their family, and grappling with the uncertainty that all of us are facing, not knowing what will come around the corner with respect to the virus. So mental health is one of the major parallel pandemics, but we've also seen, you know, growing evidence around interrupted care affecting people who suffer from chronic diseases as well, whether it's diabetes or high blood pressure or kidney disease. And then all the things that we know are inherently connected to health outcomes, you know, those social determinants of health that that many of you are scholars of and practitioners of as well. We're seeing it, unfortunately, the distal links between how we think about social determinants of health and how they end up in health outcomes or illness, all of those are shrinking with respect to the time frame by which, you know, one is connected to another. So those are the three strategic priorities that I wanted to mention. I'm very sensitive to your time, so let me wrap up with just one final note, which is that we also derive inspiration from our forebears, you know, people who have been fighting the good fight in public health for decades. And New York City has such a lineage of that. Many of you have participated in it and are participating in it. But I think, again, these historic times call for us to think about this not just over decades, but over centuries. And, you know, the historical parallel that keeps reverberating in my mind is what we were able to do in the wake of the cholera epidemics and typhus and the other infectious diseases in the middle of the 19th century, which were primarily concentrated among low-income people and often among immigrant populations. What we were able to do for the public health of all in the wake of those crises is something that I hope, even as we are in the midst of the storm right now, we will have an eye toward in the future as well, to think about the things that we can build in a way that there is a step change with respect to our public health infrastructure and the way that everyday New Yorkers think about public health as well. So I look forward to working with all of you both on the immediate crisis at hand, as well as building that future together. Thank you again for having me.
And thank you so much, Commissioner, for coming. We were delighted to hear from you, and your remarks were extremely inspiring. If you have any need for any help from any of us on the faculty or here or any of the student body or staff, do not hesitate to call. We're at the ready and very much dedicated to the city in which we reside.
Thank you so much.
And thank you. Take care.